Hello and welcome to this video presentation of BC PodTunes, an app by Binary Computing Limited. When you start BC PodTunes with no iPod attach, you'll get this warning message here that I can't find an iPod. Now the reason for this is that BC PodTunes has been designed so that it uses the iPod database and audio tracks instead of having, like iTunes, its own library. And the reason behind this is because we wanted to make this application portable, so you could, once you've installed it, you can copy the executable onto the iPod device, and then you can take the application with your iPod and plug it into any PC and run the application, and so basically you take your music collection with you. Now this application is only compatible with iPods like the iPod Classic, iPod Video. It's not designed for your iPhone or iTouch or iPad. That is a completely different type of device. And because I personally have so many iPods with different music collections on, it's the reason I wrote this application. So now I'm going to connect an iPod. You see that it appears in Windows Explorer. Now that it appears in Windows Explorer, the application will be able to find it when we do a retry. Now, when the application starts up, first thing it does, apart from reading the iPod databases, is it takes a backup copy of them. And the reason that it does this is because when people close applications and unplug their iPod devices, they tend to just disconnect it from the cable without properly removing the device. And if Windows is still writing data to the device, it can cause corruption in the database. So if you do this, you will get zero songs on the device, so you will need to recover from a backup. So when you go into the iPod, it creates this folder called BC Backups, and you've got date and time. So all you do is go to the last backup. So you close this, for example, it's shut down. You've noticed that there's files missing off your device, it's got zero songs. So then you'll just come into here and you would launch this, and it basically provides you with some information and then copies back the databases to the device. There we are, so that's all done now. So now we go and relaunch the application, which I'll do in a second. So here we go, just launching now. Okay, so now you can see we've got the iPod displayed here, Chris's iPod. Now, when you click on the iPod, it gives you every type of track that exists on the device. So that'll include any, so you've got your music, your videos, your podcasts, and your audiobooks. But when you come onto these here, these are like filters. So it'll only show you the music, only show you the videos, only show you the podcasts, only show you the audiobooks you've got. So what I'll do is just go through some of the media player features first before we go into the more in depth. So if I just sort of double click on here, it will you can see here, what it's done is copied everything in this playlist in order. It's popped it into a play queue, which you can see here on the right hand side. So now you can go to other playlists, things here, and sort. Yeah, it doesn't affect the main playlist order. Pause that here. So also another feature is that you've got an equalizer here, so you can set different types of effects, sort of adjust it, or you can set your own. You've also got lyrics. So if you're playing a song, basically what happens when the application starts, it submits a BC Lyrics Finder executable, which runs, and that goes through the entire iPod and it looks on the internet for the lyrics, as you see here, and it saves them to your iPod. So in future, as you're playing tracks, it looks on the iPod for the file, and if it's not there, it goes off to the internet to find it. But if you find that, say for example, you've imported a track, you've renamed it, and now you want to find some lyrics, if you don't want to restart the application, which will restart the search process, you can just click on Find and then click on Save, and it will save it. So it basically does what the Lyrics Finder application does. So to close any of these windows, you just X, like so. One of the other things you can do on the media player, apart from last track, play pause, next track, volume, you can slider up into the track here. You can also right click on the ratings here, and you can see here auto sets the ratings. This track here is for shuffle, so when you gets to the next track, it will randomly select one in the list. And this button is for repeat the current playing track. So that's basically the media player bits. If you want to look at audio effects, these items here, then as you're playing a track, you can click on any of these or one from this list. So let's move on to some of the editing features that we have here. To create a new playlist, you can either right click, we got options for new, rename current playlist, or delete the current playlist. Now you can only do rename and delete on the playlist that you define, so you can't select video and then do a delete. It's just not going to work because these are special filter playlists. So I'm going to create a new playlist, and I'm just going to call it Import A. And I'm going to create another playlist called My Faves. So for example here, My Faves, I'm going to select Pink Floyd, some Pink Floyd tracks. And I can either do right click, copy to playlist, My Faves. They now appear. So I'll do some different ones. And I'll do some, let's just sort an artist. Some Jar, some classic Jean-Michel Jarre. And you can drag, so you select them and you just drag over. You notice you can't do these here. These are not allowing it. They're saying, "Ooh, naughty, they're filter playlists." So do that onto My Faves, and then when you click on here, they arrive. Now, when you delete a playlist or rename it, you delete the tracks that are in that playlist, but they're not deleted from the iPod. They're literally just removed from the playlist. So what I'll do is I'll just show you, I'll do a delete playlist faves. So let's jump back to the master playlist, if you like. So they're still there, Pink Floyd. So what I want to do now is I'm going to import some media. And here I'm going to add a folder. I've got to remember where I put my samples. Search subfolders. So here we've got some Green Day, Zuluk. Snow Patrol. So what I'll do, I'll just get rid of that. So you can select the tracks you don't want, and you can just hit the delete key, and it removes them so it won't import them. Now down here, you can either specify a new playlist, or you can select an existing playlist. So I'm going to do import A. Click OK. Now it's going to start importing those tracks to the device and update the playlist. Almost there now. Okay, so that's imported those tracks. So we've got music, which just have the music. Your videos, which will have your videos. Podcast, audiobook. Now, there's no reason why you can't change one of your audio tracks to become an audio book or a podcast. If you right click and do properties, there's a feature here called type. So you can literally set its type here. I mean, I don't know why you'd want to say make an audio track a video, but the option is there. So say change that to a podcast, click OK. Let's perform the update and go on to a podcast, and now you see the track is there. Now, when playing videos, you need to have a codec pack called K-Lite installed, and then it will be able to play your MP4 videos and MOV and things like that. But if you have a DRM protected video that you've purchased through iTunes and you try and run it, you're going to get this error come up. Yeah, so it's unable to play the item. And the reason this is, the item was purchased through the Apple Store and has DRM protection. The video codec is not available. Make sure K-Lite codec. Or the video codec is locked by another program, so it could be another media player that has the file open. So that's the error you would get there. The other options we have here are filter, so you could say the wall, and it filters with anything with the wall in. And to reset that, click clear. What else have we got here? adding a CD. So on the CD, again, you can select the playlist if you want it to go into a playlist. I mean, there's no CD in at the moment, so I'll insert a CD. Just got to find a CD. To be more prepared. Oh, come on. Let's do James Blunt. So I'll just make sure there's no James Blunt here already. No, there's no James Blunt. Okay, get rid of that. So there's nothing in there. Okay, so let's clear that. Import CD. And so what it does is you select the, you might, if you've got multiple players installed, you select the CD you want. It's automatically gone to the internet to get track information. If it, for some reason it doesn't, you can click on get track info or refresh, and it will try and go out again and get it. It'll automatically pull down the cover. If you need to change it, then just do a plus here and then you can select the cover. Right, so the other options here, you can set to AAC or WAV, so that'll be MP4 or WAV, and you can set that to an audiobook or a compilation CD if you wish. Right, so without boring you too much, I'll import that as an MP3 into my import list. Now I'll start the recording. If it detects a track with the same album and artist name, it will inform you that you've got the album already on your iPod and ask you if you want to continue. So what it would do is, if you've got, say, 1 out of 10 tracks on your iPod, from that album, it will just skip the track it knows exists there, and it will just import all the other tracks. So that's really as simple as that, really. I mean, I have a lot of CDs. I still buy my stuff on CDs mostly, so I use this feature. So I'll just let this continue for a bit. So just like when you add tracks from folder, it performs the same import function that you can see here. So when it rips a CD, it basically initially will convert it to 32-bit high definition audio, and then it takes that high quality and then puts it into an MP3, AAC, or a normal standard WAV file that Windows can understand. Right, so there you go, that's imported here. Help folder, you can check for update. Got an about box, tells you the version number. You can go onto the website FAQ page. If you get any issues running the software, go to the FAQ page. And if you find that the software is not behaving correctly, for example, if the software crashes, it should trap it and give you the opportunity to send me the log files so that I can investigate the problem. But if you notice it's behaving badly and you want to send me the log files with a comment, then you can just literally click that option, send logs, enter description, crashed when I clicked on, or whatever message you want to put, and then it goes off and it sends me the log file, as you can just hear it probably in the background, it just arrived. So that's it really. Some other couple of things here, you can close that window down so you've got more work area. This is a refresh to reload the page. If for any reason you're editing or you import stuff and it doesn't, it's very rare, but if it doesn't list all of the stuff and the changes you made, you can click on that button and it does that. So that's it for now. Any questions? You want me to make a video to describe certain anything really that you can think of with this app? Then just send us an email, and you know, we'll update our FAQ page, and or if there's any features you think it should need, then let us know, and we'll look into adding those too. Bye for now.